This is my remote, but it should work for yours.
All right. Perfect. Hi, everyone. How are you today? Good to see everyone. We're going to get started. It's a little bit small, but I know that people are going to be filtering in as the morning moves on. I'm Danny Norden, and I am one of the co-organizers, along with Jason Pimentel, Susan McPhee, and a whole host of other fantastic people of Design for Drupal Boston. I'm going to let Jason talk a little bit about the camp, and then we're going to go over today's agenda, talk about the group photo and raffle that's happening right before lunch, and then we will introduce Steve Fisher, our keynote address today. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm going to actually start off very slowly because I know a lot of people are still just walking in. But I think that for those of you that have been here before, it's I know that you appreciate the fact that we have an event about Drupal that's really kind of focused on design. But I think one of the things that we tried to do this year was actually turn that up to 11 a little bit more, because we wanted to really be sure that we drew a pretty hard line about the sessions that we chose, and focused the tracks a little bit more to try and think of this not as a Drupal camp that's focused on design, but actually a really great web design conference that happens to be related to Drupal. And that was an important distinction for us, and it was certainly something that was very much on my mind when I got the opportunity to help out this year. And so in doing so, we started thinking about the tracks and really starting to hone in on all aspects of design as one piece of it, and the other piece really being purely front-end development and theming, and keeping everything about module development and developer operations and stuff like that kind of off the table. But what came out of that discussion initially was a realization that there are a lot of sessions and great ideas that relate to running the teams and running the businesses. So that's actually what happened with yesterday's track. So yesterday we were offering sessions that were really focused on helping people who own shops or run teams to keep Drupal and design in the middle of how they work. And I think that that ended up being very successful. We had some really great talks. We had a lot of great feedback. And then with today, we've tried to keep it balanced so that there's always a couple of design sessions and a couple of front-end sessions going on at the same time. You can always choose. Many of them are being recorded, and they'll be available on the MIT Tech TV site usually within a day or two. And there's actually a whole library of them there. But we really hope that you'll enjoy this, and you'll come away with lots of modern ideas about how to work with Drupal, and come back next year for even more. So thank you, everyone, and I think we're going to go into people who support the conference.
Yes. Well, and a little bit about the schedule. So right after we give our opening remarks, we're going to have Steve Fisher from Republic of Quality give our keynote address. We also have sessions going all day. After the 12:30 session, everyone should pile into the auditorium because we're going to be doing our group photo. We're also going to be raffling away our prizes. We have some really interesting prizes this year. We have two free licenses for Agsure, the prototyping tool. We also have two copies of Drupal for Designers, which is my book. And two free workshops with Christina Inge of Thoughtlight. Is that her? That's her business, right? Either way. Two free SEO and digital marketing workshops with Christina Inge. So make sure that after the 12:30 session, everyone comes right into the auditorium. We'll get that taken care of, and then we're going to have a delicious lunch. And actually the other thing is that our Saturday reception is actually at WeWork and General Assembly. And that's actually a space that is in the Fort Point area. It's a very quick couple of stops on the Red Line and then a walk over the river, and then you're there. The reason we did that is because while Cambridge, which is where we are now, is an innovation hub in the city, in the area of Boston, Fort Point Channel is a very rapidly growing innovation hub that is complementary to to Cambridge. So we wanted to give everyone here a taste of the best of Boston, which includes riding on the T and going to Fort Point and looking at all of the different innovation stuff. And General Assembly has a really great space. They're going to have a specialty cocktail for us. We're going to have cheese. We're going to have wine and beer. It's going to be a really fun time in a really cool space. On Sunday, we have two trainings that are still available. You can still buy tickets for them. The first is a responsive web design boot camp with Stephen Cross and Jason Pimentel. And the second is an intro to Drupal 8 theming with Forrest Mars. Both of those tickets are available. They'll be in the larger classrooms. And you can go right on the site and register, and you can buy those tickets. They're $350. We also have Design for Drupal's very first contribution sprint all day on Sunday. So what we want is designers, coders, developers, anyone who feels like they want to contribute to Drupal, don't be worried. You can contribute. We have stuff for you to work on. We also have Leslie and Kay from Own Sourcing doing a workshop on how to do core contribution, how to get everything set up so you can start contributing to core right away. So if you are a tech writer, if you are a designer, if you are a UX person, if you are a developer, a front-end web designer, anything, come and contribute and give back to Drupal. We'd love to have you there. And those are going to be in the classroom downstairs. That's another thing that we want to note about today, is that we have one track that's actually in the classroom in the basement, and those are going to be interesting demos. There's a couple of interesting development tools that people are featuring here through Design for Drupal. So that's going to be happening in the training classroom downstairs, as are the sprints on Sunday. So we want to thank our sponsors, the design and development partners, Atten Design and Redfin Solutions. They're responsible for making our site actually work and help and give us the information. And they also branded the camp. The Zen Kitchen is my organization, and H&W is Jason. We worked on the content. We also helped manage registrations. And McPhee Design Group, Susan McPhee, she actually was our sponsorship coordinator, so she helped wrangle the sponsors and get money so that we can pay for all of this great stuff. We also want to thank Own Sourcing for providing us with training and for helping us wrangle volunteers, MIT for providing this amazing space and some of the amenities that we're experiencing today, and Christina Inge, our incredible marketing coordinator, who is responsible for all the tweets you're seeing from the D4D Boston account, all of the emails that you've been getting reminding you of all the great stuff that's happening in the camp. She's been really terrific. Our gold sponsors are OOMPH, which is based in, I think, Boston and Providence and a bunch of other places. Acquia is also a gold sponsor. And we have also our silver sponsors include Last Call Media, North Point Digital, Pantheon, Isovera, and Lingotech. And they're going to be giving presentations today. And we also have phase two, and unfortunately, this slide got updated right before Lullabot signed up. Lullabot is also a sponsor, and as well as BioRaft and Soft Askew. And we want to thank our volunteers. Anyone who is a volunteer, can you please stand up? Please give them a round of applause. We would not be able to make this happen without them. And a couple housekeeping notes. Make sure you pick up your trash. Please recycle your lanyards at the end of Sunday. We do have recycling and composting bins, so if you have food scraps, you can feel free to put those in the composting bins and not the regular trash, and no cell phones in the session rooms. Last bit of business, MIT Guest is the wireless network. You can also use MITN, and D4D Boston is the Twitter hashtag. And we already know about the fabulous prizes. Everyone come in after the 12:30 session, come into the auditorium. We will be giving away prizes. and doing the group photo. And we need your help to make 2015 better. If you want to volunteer for any of the roles that are listed above, we're also looking for a treasurer to help us manage the finances and understand how much we have to spend. Please come see me, Susan McPhee, who's back there, or Jason, and we would be happy to talk to you about a role that you would fit into. All right, and with that, let's welcome Steve.
So I kind of told Danny this morning that I really wanted to introduce Steve because he's actually been somebody I've known and looked up to for many years for a number of reasons. And it actually ties very nicely into our community and the way that we've actually tried to structure our own business. So H&W Design is husband and wife. That's my wife and I. We've been working together for about 3.5 years with one company and then more recently with our own. And one of the reasons that we decided to do that was because we wanted to be able to live our own life and conduct ourselves professionally in a way that was a little bit more compatible than working in a traditional startup. And Steve has made a lot of similar decisions in his life, I think. And he and his wife both are really good friends. And that's something that really resonates with this community as a whole. And we talked about the volunteerism that goes into running camps like this, that makes DrupalCons work, that makes all the local camps and meetups work. And it's something that is what makes Drupal possible. And without that, none of us would be here, and none of us would be making a really great living using this software to help us build great ideas. So keeping that in mind and central to how we think and do and work and conduct ourselves here, I think is absolutely essential. And taking that whole mentality and extending that to how we do our work for our clients, how we think about user experience, how we think about all of these factors delivering a great solution for the end user is really very much at the heart of what Steve does. And he's done that in a number of different companies, and most recently he's been doing that with his wife. And Republic of Quality is something that started about a similar time frame to H&W. And it's been really wonderful to see that develop and see the kinds of things that they've been doing. And so with that, I'd really like to extend the warmest of welcomes to my good friend Steve and have him talk to you about the Wholehearted user experience.
I'm going to break the first rule. I'm going to use my cell phone. Okay. Let's make everyone jealous that's outside that hasn't walked in yet. On three, we're all going to cheer, and I'm going to pretend like I had a successful presentation. One, two, three. Yeah! I probably didn't make too many people jealous, but okay. I'll put my cell phone down now. Let me just switch over to the presentation here. I'm really happy to be back in the Boston area. I realized, I was telling Danny this morning, just that the last time I was here was actually for Design for Drupal in 2010. I was working for a great company called Palantir. I was one of their user experience people there, and I really enjoyed my time here. I have always loved the Drupal community since I joined it. I came from the Joomla community at the time. I was involved quite a bit there, but have really loved open source in general and the philosophy behind it. Anytime I've been asked to give a TEDx talk, I always say I just want to talk about open source and how that can change how we see the world. But I am at the Republic of Quality. As Jason already said, I basically am half of the Republic of Quality. If you're ever looking to get a hold of me, this is the best way. You can just go to the website or Twitter. I love Twitter. This is what I used to look like all the time. This is slightly more accurate now. I forgot to bring my on-brand tie. The things you should know about me, though, is I'm a great designer and obviously very humble Canadian. But sometimes I'm not good at everything. Yeah, that was my first try at hula hoop. This is my daughter's first try at hula hoop. Yeah. What a jerk. No, I love my family. This is my wife, Shannon. She is a content strategist and a writer. She's a little bit crazy at times, which I love. This is my daughter, Emma. We share a photography bug. We constantly go out in Vancouver, take photos. She's also crazy. You can find her in the Gatorade section of the grocery store. They take crazy selfies of each other. And the reason I'm giving you this kind of intro to this is we're going to talk about wholehearted experiences. And a big part of that, and you probably have heard about this a lot, is actually, you know, talking to people, right? That's one of the biggest keys to web design, web development, to user experience, to content strategy. Not just people, though, sometimes. This is my dog, Sloan. She comes to work with me. She does business. That's what she looks like in the morning. She always goes under the covers. She's a beautiful, beautiful Vizsla, Hungarian hunting dog. She looks like a deer and is afraid of the water. This is my other dog, Neville. Aww, he's just a puppy still. He's a German short hair pointer who loves the water. And this is where I live. So I work, you can kind of see that pointy building over there. My office is right near there. This is Vancouver on the other side of the continent. This is what it looked like when I was going to move there. So I went up to Whistler, I could go snowboarding, go hiking in the mountains. We were staying downtown. We were just in love with this area. And then we moved to Vancouver. Yeah. So someone apologized to me today about the rain. I was like, oh no, it's like I'm home. I love to cycle, something I have in common with Jason, although I don't do the century, like 100-mile trips currently at all. When I moved to Vancouver, I had to upgrade my bike a little bit to get used to the rain. And then I realized Vancouver is very hipsterish, and so I started to expand my bike a little bit, customize it, build it out. And then I got hit by an SUV. Yeah, I know, my bike frame, so I got broadsided on this leg, and my bike frame bent. Somehow, those are all of the injuries I had, though. No broken bones, no concussion, didn't hit my head. I fell down on the ground, popped up in front of the SUV, and just yelled, "What the hell?" They were, of course, a polite Canadian, and picked up my bike for me, put it in the back of their SUV, drove me to my bike shop and to the doctor, apologizing, saying sorry the whole time. I rebuilt my bike. It's even better now. I love it. I take really dangerous cycling selfies, which I kind of made a connection at some point. Anyways, if you want to know more about me or Vancouver, go to haveaproblem.com. But let's get back to work here. So this is my personal site, which honestly, I don't even update anymore. I've been just batting around what I'm going to do with it, because since I started the Republic of Quality, that's where a lot of my content goes. But one day I decided I'm going to bring it up on some of the devices I just had sitting around. And I've got quite a few, you know, to see how does a responsive site perform on an old Kindle and all that. Because things have changed so much for us. I was thinking back to 2010, the last time I was here. You know, and what was really important and what we were focusing on. The mobile web was important, but it was hard to sell that at that time even. We could talk about apps, we could talk about different things, but making experiences for mobile devices was harder then, right? At least ones that we really connected with. I'm gonna pause for a moment and just say, when I started to think about this talk in particular, and I'm gonna say about as Canadian as I can for you, and I'm gonna say process. Larry's really familiar with that there. I've kind of made his day, I think. It's not process. It's not spelled that way. Come on. No, it's process. No Americans laughing at the Canadian now? I make really awkward jokes about America and Canada, so just deal with it. But the responsive web, the wholehearted experiences, what does this really mean? And I got thinking about how we're a society of likes, right? I probably should have had the Facebook like hand up here. And how we spend so much time liking things, you know, that we get together with like-minded people, we like things on Facebook, you know, we generally do that, and it seems like a great way to get along, right? And it's not. That's kind of bullshit. And I actually don't agree with statements where people say that Facebook is only people gathering in like-minded groups. I see lots of debates erupt on Facebook, and I love that, right? I love it when people have the opportunity to disagree and have conflict. I don't like fighting. I'm not like in favor of just deliberately trying to make conflict. But unless we have those discussions, we can't get to some of the deeper moments. So that's part of what this talk will be about today. We used to look at the web like this, right? Interesting note is my daughter didn't recognize this logo. Yeah, I thought that, well, I didn't know if I was doing something wrong or not, actually, at that point, because I thought, oh, I'm talking about living like this wholehearted life and you don't recognize, you know, Microsoft. But then the web shifted to something a little bit more like this, right, where we're starting to look at all these different devices, different browsers, different experiences that we can no longer control. You know, we have less and less control is what seems to happen. All right, so what does this mean for us? Well, if we were to take a look at a comparison of just Android devices, which I'm currently using right now, you know, it gets a little overwhelming. So I'm going to look at this with you here. So the first two columns are the name of the device, the date it was released. Next one is the operating system. And then if we get in a little bit further, we're seeing that the screen's resolution, right? And so those third and fourth columns, and this is actually from almost a year ago. I forgot to put them in the right slide here. But you can see there is no combination the same as we go through. And the problem that we see is this, the scroll bar over here. Like, I'm going to go through hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of devices here. Right now, if you go to Wikipedia, you end up in the future or other devices section at the bottom, which is things like heads-up displays for snowboarding, skiing goggles, Google Glass, different things like that. And what does it mean when we start to bring our experiences there? Right? Because we used to be so concerned about IE, right? And everyone laughs a little bit when I show that IE slide, and, you know, and maybe we had this kind of celebration, right, where we were saying goodbye to IE6, which was a great browser when it came out. It was a fantastic browser, right, at that time. It just wasn't supposed to live for 12 years. You know, or what about this? What do we do when we're trying to engage with people using our websites, our apps, different things on Google Glass, which is an immersive experience, right? It's not a tiny screen, even though it is, right? You know, or things like this. I don't have mine on right now because I realize it's super distracting during a talk because I always forget to turn it off. But a Pebble Watch. What if we're trying to deliver our content to something like this? Now, I know it's not really a web browsing device, but there is web content, content coming from our databases that can be delivered to a 1.26-inch e-paper display screen. Right? What are we going to deliver? My friend Brad talks about atomic web design, and I remember him talking to me about this at South by Southwest 2 years ago, and just, it's a great system. Anyone here use or talk about design systems in this way? Okay, a few of you. Basically, he talks about atoms as sort of this, the smallest element, you know, which is where, like, the atomic stuff works up until about here, and then starts to break down a little bit, but atoms being, this could be like the box for a search experience, right? And a molecule might be the button and the box, so it comes together, right? Organisms could be a complex form, and then templates and so on, right? We get going up there. And it's this great way to think about design systems so that we're not trying to design for a particular device. We start to abstract these things. I would encourage you to read this blog post and to see, is this worth me considering? But the one thing is, Brad doesn't talk at all about people during that. Right? This is not the web. The web that we're building for is not a bunch of machines. Technically, yes, it is on machines and hosted there. I just watched Transcendence on the plane yesterday, and I hope the web never becomes that, but we're interacting with one person to another. The reason we are building our websites and our content and our designs is so that someone else can use it and connect to someone else. So that's maybe a little bit more obvious on things like Facebook, but really, if you start to think about it, even a business like Best Buy, somebody is in control there. It's someone is making money, right? And they're connecting people to people, right? The problem that we live in, though, right now, as Karen McGrain describes it, is this content in a zombie apocalypse, meaning we have all these devices, right? We have no longer have control over it. We had this picture of, you know, the screen always getting bigger, then the iPhone came out, and interesting note, maybe some of you know this, but the Android devices at that time when the iPhone came out already could do multitasking. But Steve Jobs sold it so effectively that they took a step back and said, we have to think about this differently. think differently. Way to go, Steve Jobs. But we live in this place now where we just have thousands of devices, right? And we have very little control over what's going to happen. And we have great expectations. So we're going to talk a little bit history lesson here of the web. So this might be taking you back. This might be stuff that you already know, probably is. But I think it's a good reminder. So 2007, Steve Jobs announces the iPhone. Yeah, it's kind of the spit take moment where we've got this pinch and zoom experience where we can finally use the web on a mobile device in a way that, you know, holy crap, this will work. Right before that, I remember using my Nokia and my BlackBerry. That's right, BlackBerry, Canadian. And it just wasn't good enough, right? So the reason I didn't put up a mobile phone for the smaller screen, though, is it really wasn't that, right? It was us using a standard Safari experience that we could pinch and zoom. It was great. It was this big celebration, sort of happy. If you make me pinch and zoom now, though, it is a broken experience. So, yeah, it's very sad, very, very sad. Then we had the M dot, right, that comes out. So this awesome experience where we can deliver, you know, interaction patterns, content differently to a small screen, right? And we can have this happy experience on a large screen still too. But that's broken as well, because we're actually delivering two different sites, right? This isn't endorsed by any major search engine. Yeah, don't do that, seriously. And so that doesn't really work for us, right? Who is the authority when Google goes to search? Is it the M.dot site or the other? Are we going to deliver different content to different devices? Maybe, but I wouldn't recommend that, at least not very often. And then we had the responsive web, right? So it is kind of this happy moment across all devices. I know that it's not the magic silver bullet, because there's a lot to be considered with in what we're delivering, but it really does fit a lot better. It's a bit more of a celebration. It even gets a non-bearded Steve thumbs up, right? So we went from this really fragmented experience to this opportunity where I feel like the responsive web allowed us to begin to understand our medium a little bit better, right? Where it forced us to say, okay, we can't. Well, less people are talking about pixel perfect designs. I had a chat with Jason and Danny about that this morning, but because we realize our medium is fluid, right? And that it's going to be delivered to people in the way that they want to consume it. We can't control it, whether it's opening up on an RSS feed, the website itself on a different device. And so the responsive web has forced us to think about our medium differently, and I love that. I love that it was brain-busting. When we're thinking about wholehearted experiences, though, and how to design for them, there's a philosophy that always makes it into every one of my talks, and it's called the Golden Circle. Is anyone here familiar with the Golden Circle by Simon Sinek? Or Start with the Why is what he calls his book. Okay, I'm often surprised how many people haven't heard of this. But there's these three concentric circles. The first one is what. So we talk about what we can do. Everybody can answer what we do. What do you do? What's your title, job title?
Web development.
Okay, Larry.
Senior architect.
Senior architect, yeah. How about you? Front-end developer. That's an easy question to answer. We can all answer the what, right? I'm an experienced architect, right? I can tell you what it is that I do. How I do what I do is a little bit more complicated, right? How many of you have ever been in a meeting where someone asks you to do something, or your team something, and you just kind of nod and go, oh, yeah, we could do that. And then you walk away, and you look at each other and go, oh, crap, we got to learn how to do that. Anyone ever been in a meeting like that? Yeah, because we work on the web, and we're creating it. And it's harder to describe how we do the things we do. Maybe 60, 70% of us could really describe that very effectively. And even then, it's still growing. But then there's the why, this fuzzy middle core that hardly any of us can describe why we do the things we do. And Simon Sinek gives this example. He gives lots of examples, but the one in his TED Talk is of Apple computers and a generic PC company. So I'm not an Apple fanboy. I use all sorts of different systems. But I found this really compelling, because he talks about how Apple computer, or this PC company, rather, what do they do? Well, they build PCs, right? That's a pretty obvious answer. You know, they're going to build these computers so people can do their work. Well, how do they do that? They source out different parts. If you're manufacturers, they try to make it as cost-effective to their business model as possible so they can make money. Why do they do it? Well, they could describe that they're trying to deliver these systems to companies, but they're also making money. It's good business. Just makes sense. He talks then about Apple computers and how the vision, at least initially, although sometimes it feels like this has been lost now, was to think differently, to change the world. And how? Well, how we're going to source our parts differently. We're going to keep a lot of control. You know, we're going to do that part differently as well. And what? Well, it's all these products that we see around us. You know, and if you look back through the history of computing, there's been a lot of systems that have changed how we do things. But the announcement of the iPhone, the iPod, some of these other things really did change how we looked at things. And so I can connect that vision, that why, with what they're doing, and suddenly I want to spend more money on a computer, right? I'm more compelled because I understand their why. I want to change the world as well. I do. And so understanding that fuzzy core, that why, helps change our motivation as we move forward. So we need to think differently, change our lenses, when we actually start to design for the web. All right. So I just need the audio up, make sure it's on there. But fair warning, actually, this is an interesting story I should tell. Every presentation I do has a zombie video in it. That started at Drupal Camp Chicago in 2009. That was the very first time I did that, and I thought, oh, I love zombies. Why haven't I been doing this? So Drupal kicked that off. But here, let's take a look at this. Anyone familiar with the show The Walking Dead? Okay. Anybody not know what a zombie is? Someone in the back. You're joking, though, I bet. No, I've had that happen. The one thing I love about the zombie genre is it tells the same story over and over and over, right? Someone probably wakes up, let's say 28 days later, in a hospital, there's paper blowing around Boston or something, because it was in Boston this time, and you know, they get outside and everyone's gone, right? No one's around, some apocalyptic event happened, but not everything's blown up, so it doesn't all make sense. And then they run into this creature that they don't understand. They somehow fight it off, they injure its head or break its neck and make their way away. They understand that's how to kill it. They meet up with a few other people. Those people, probably most of them die off, and they realize their situation is hopeless, but they're trying to survive. Same story over and over and over. And I love that we see how it's told differently every time. Alternate opening to that. And it's really easy in the zombie genre or in life to focus on this, the apocalypse, the disaster. Disasters happen, you know, as I'm sure everyone in this room well knows. The amazing thing for me about every zombie movie and the thing that I actually love isn't the gore. I actually am very squeamish, which makes this genre odd for me, but is the humanity, how we retain our humanity throughout. So you start to think about Karen McGrain, how she talks about the zombie apocalypse of devices, right? And how there's just so many different ways to connect, and how she talks about content being the unification process in there, or part of that. It's really us trying to figure out how to connect people to people, right? When we go out and design things, we shouldn't necessarily just be thinking about the business goals, right? That's important, but we need to talk to people, right? Being a listener is the best part, or the best skill you can have as a designer. Right, listening and understanding. So I love the zombie genre because it tells the humanity story, right? How do they try to hold on to the humanity in this apocalypse? Because really, it's all about rocks. Yeah, not this. That was like a radio show shift, you know, where they tell you this awful story and then they go into like this really positive, and someone's birthday today. No, so it's not this guy. We're not gonna talk about him, not Dwayne Johnson, but this, sorta, right? It's about starting with the right stuff. So another book reference here. Anybody know Seven Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey? Yeah, it's another great one. Whether you are looking to use your time better or think differently, I would still recommend reading it or a podcast, or even starting with First Things First. It's a shorter version of it, essentially. Right? And what happens here in this philosophy is there's these four quadrants. And the first one is the urgent importance. So that could be things like, you know, I'm having a heart attack, I need to go in an ambulance right now. Or our site needs to launch tomorrow or this business will fail, right? That's urgent and important. Non-urgent important, those are things like going for a run, training on your bike, eating well, you know, taking time to learn something so that you can graduate from university or college. Those things take time, right? And it's a lot of training that happens. But they're not urgent, because it's not going to happen right away. For me to run a marathon, I need to run a little bit, or a lot, every day, you know, for 4 or 5 months, so that at the end of that, I can go out and do that comfortably. Well, comfortably. Urgent, not important. Things like, hey, there's pancakes for breakfast in the conference room. Well, by lunch, they're not going to be very good, right? So it's not really important, but it is urgent. And then there's other things that are non-urgent, non-important. Like, let's say YouTube or television, things like that, where I'm going to admit, I watch a lot of Netflix. I know that there's a lot of that that maybe isn't very important to me. But it is neither urgent nor important, right? And what we should be focusing on our projects and in general in life is the one that's very, very difficult to focus on. It's this, the non-urgent important, the training things. That's what setting out a user experience vision, talking to your users at the start of the project instead of realizing later that you didn't understand what they actually needed and talking to them throughout. So when I sketched out this presentation, this is what it looked like. That's my living room whiteboard, right? I'm that big of a geek. I put a whiteboard up in my living room. And this is generally what we're going to cover today. One of the first things is your audience, right? And I know that people, like we talk about doing user experience design and talking to our users, and people make jokes about there's only one other industry that talks about users. It's the drugs, we, you know, you are a user of drugs. I don't care if you call them users or people or whatever, as long as you focus on that it is humans that we are talking about here. So when we look at our audience, this is an example of what we want them to say.
The thing I really love about the Republic of Quality working with Steve is that we work on solutions that are built for and around our customers.
Holy beard and mustache.
And oftentimes, any old organization can work on a technical solution first, but actually being sometimes forced to think about our customers before we build our actual solutions makes us more in touch with that particular audience. We are better because we're thinking about them before we actually start to build anything. So all that thought and all that consideration means that our products last longer, more sustainable, and better in touch with the people we're trying to serve in the first place. And I think I can think of no better way to sort of...
All right, good. I don't want that to be an ad for the Republic of Quality. We're quite busy, although we welcome working with people. But you know, it was such a great experience to get to the end of working with this large municipality of about 1 million people, and for them to say the most important part was to actually be forced to talk to the people who are using our services, right? Because a city is like a mile wide and an inch deep. It provides all the services to all the people, right? And so it's very hard to think about all these things in a design system, right? But being forced to not only think about the head, but think about the heart. Right, that's good user experience, is connecting the head to the heart. If I were to describe what a wholehearted experience is, that's what it is. Really, that's just good user experience, though, period. So what would the zombie movie look like for that?
What am I doing with my life? I just want to connect. Why can't I connect with people? Oh, right, it's because I'm dead. I wish I could introduce myself, but I don't remember my name. I think it started with an R. That's all I have left. It's kind of a bummer. I shouldn't be so hard on myself. I mean, we're all dead. This is my best friend. We even have almost conversations sometimes. They call these guys bonies. They'll eat anything with a heartbeat. I mean, I will too, but at least I'm conflicted about it. Nice watch.
Changing, and he feels, and he's learning to be human again.
Oh my God, is that him?
Yeah. Set.
You started something here. Whatever it is that you two have, it's infecting the others.
Dad, there's...
Okay. It's a great, funny movie. It still tells the same story, but it shifts it right there at the end. And when this came out, and I was, thinking about talks, because as soon as I see a zombie movie, I was like, how's that fit in with talk? But the bonies, those creatures there, let's describe them as the companies out there that don't give a shit about their users at all, right? Okay. That's none of you, but some people out there, we may have even worked for a company like that, and it feels like the heart is gone. But the rest of us often are like the zombies. To be honest, I'm just like it a lot of times too, where we're just going through the motions. You know, we're barely having conversations with people beside us, you know, until we connect, and then our heart starts beating again, right? So when it got to this moment where I'm just past it here, where the rest of the zombies, their hearts start beating again, they start transforming back into humans, right? That's the opportunity that we have by creating these wholehearted experiences, by talking about them, by saying we're gonna talk to our users, we're gonna talk to these people, and we're gonna tell other companies why we're doing that. You know, and that's not only is that gonna be great for the people using the products, using the websites, it's gonna be great for your business when it starts to generate more success, right? The results that are coming out. But also, it creates this better ecosystem in our design community, right? Because sometimes we are trying to connect with real people that have real needs. In fact, I think that's all the time. Not an ad for that app, but very few devices in the world have changed the life of people that are non-sighted than devices like the iPhone, right? Where the accessibility features are sort of off the charts at times and what they are able to do. Now, this is a very specific use case, but honestly, when you start to create accessible designs, when you start to actually provide these experiences that can meet both the head and the heart, is so moving, but it can change the world around us. So it starts with talking with the audience, but then there's setting the user experience vision. I'm gonna talk about maybe a really boring project as a case study when we go through here, a couple of them actually. But this is for a smaller municipality of maybe 200,000 people in Canada, the city of Red Deer, real name. So they sat down with myself and another content strategist, and it was their IT team lead, their IT manager, their communications director, and their content lead content person. And we crafted this vision together. We talked about audiences. So it's a web-first organization that empowers anyone to access City of Red Deer information and services in any way they choose. Yeah, you know, kind of broad, but we did this together in a way that wasn't meant to be wordsmith. It was meant to begin to focus us, if you can picture the Venn diagram of, you know, vision over here and reality here, and there's just a slight overlap, and we're always trying to move towards the vision. They wanted to be able to say, they'd had their website for 11 years prior to this. No significant updates, if you can imagine the horror of that. But they want to say, you know what, we provide our information first on the web. They're pursuing a CAPE model, you know, create anywhere, publish everywhere. And they wanted to empower anyone within the city of Red Deer or access that information in any way they choose, meaning it's accessible, it's on any device, right? These were the things that they said were important to them. So we sat down together in a room, workshop that collaboratively. We then move forward with design principles, So there are general design principles for user experience. You can have a design principles for your company, you know, but it's important to set them for a project. And these become the guideposts, the why statements, that when we make a decision to say, should we have that giant content rotator on our homepage? And we look at our design principles and say, one of them said things needed to be fast, and needed to be accessible. You know, maybe we shouldn't. They guide us to the right decisions. So I'm going to ask you something. Who is this? These are their design principles. So I'm not going to explain them too much, though. Universal, human, clean, consistent, useful, fast, and transparent. So who is this? Any guesses? Google? Okay, that's a good guess. Any other guesses?
It's the wrong guess, but it's a good one.
Is it Drupal?
Maybe, that's a good guess. Surprise, transparent, it's Facebook. Right, of course, because Facebook is transparent. You know, but when you start to think about how people talk about transparency, I wish it was about everything that they did, that we weren't a giant social experiment for them. But what if it was transparency into each other's lives, too? What if that was part of it, that we allowed to see these things, right? We can talk about the like society, but honestly, I post as many things that are difficult for me on Facebook because my friends are on there with me, too, right? How many of you use Facebook Paper or are familiar with it? That's kind of what I expected. But let's just take a look at their video for Paper and think about those design principles.
Stories come in all shapes and sizes. They can be told with words or with a single picture. And how each story is told is as important as the story itself. Whether it's from a far-off land, a moment shared by a friend, the latest from the front page, or a cat-sized tale set in outer space. So we've created a way to enjoy your friends' stories and discover a range of new subjects.
So Facebook Paper is actually a very immersive, compelling experience on your iPhone. Right? If you don't have an iPhone, you're screwed, I think. I haven't tried it on my Android. I don't think there is an app. Maybe there's an app for that. Probably is. But you know, it began to connect when I thought about their design principles and what they're trying to do here. I thought, maybe they are reaching out in different ways, because Facebook has a suite of apps. That's what they're moving towards. They're now forcing you to use Messenger, though. But and you start to think about their design principles again, right? These things, were they true? Huh. But there's one of them that is very important. It's useful and fast. And I actually found this to be less useful. And this is what it was like the first time I tried to access paper at a hotel in Portland. Yeah, hotel Wi-Fi. And I have no controls now. I just have this arrow, and I have no way of pausing the video to let more buffer, you know, and this just kept happening. And so it's interesting, even when we design our experiences, if they had looked at this and thought, are these design principles really important to us? Maybe they said at that point that, you know, we need to focus more on this big personal experience than fast. But they should have looked at those things, and they probably did, and made a hard decision. Design principles are our guideposts. They should keep us headed towards that vision, right? They're not necessarily measurable, right? That's what goals would be for. But they are the things, the why statements, that keep us on the right track. So if we look at the city of Red Deer, this was us when we were starting to craft out their vision across the top. At the time, it was Cope. We came, then moved on to Cape. Create once, publish everywhere. Create anywhere, publish everywhere. The two different concepts there. If we think about an example where someone didn't think about their audiences and what how they're using them, would be Starbucks. Anyone familiar with the Starbucks responsive launch from a couple years ago? Perfect. Then I can make up anything I want. So if we were picturing just a real simple lo-fi wireframe, if this was their site ID, their logo, right? Some navigation, a giant blob of content, of HTML content here. This is a product page. Blob, of course, is the technical term. Another blob, which they called their sidebar. Only do that if you're building with WordPress, please. I hope someone got the WordPress joke there. Yeah, they call it a sidebar no matter where it is. And then the footer there, right? And then their call to action. So as a product page, this call to action, this layout, generally on a larger screen, kind of makes sense, right? We can navigate, we can see things, but they didn't think about their priorities or the content or even the smaller discrete chunks of content. And so this is what happened when we're on a smaller screen, right? This call to action was lost, right? And so it's this really sad moment. What they should have done, what they eventually did do, is think about smaller discrete chunks of content. Think about their audiences, because a lot of us use our phones. A lot of us use small screen devices, especially when we're in a Starbucks or things like that. So if they had their site ID, their logo, their navigation, a page title, right? Or a view title, depending on how you're looking at it here. A piece of intro copy, deck copy, clarity copy, whatever you call it. So now we can understand what the product, what it is and what it's about. Supporting product information, a discrete chunk of content that is the call to action all on its own. All right, a secondary area, not a sidebar, and the footer, where we have a lot of our legal information, right? So this call to action is prioritized here within all of it so that we have this great call to action here. Now, I'm not a believer of above the fold or anything like that, but there's a great company in Vancouver called Mobify that did studies on calls to action related to the mobile web specifically, you know, and they saw that about 85% more sales when you could see the buy now button as the page loaded, right? And that kind of makes sense. So right here, they're able to deliver their logo, their navigation, the title, a bit of intro, clarity copy, and the ability to actually take action if you wanted to. They thought about their audiences and how they're using it and prioritized their content and created this great experience. Astonishing, I know. So, what system is best? Oh, wrong slide. No. I don't know if that's even funny anymore or not, actually. But I went for it. I'm not actually saying that Drupal is the best system. But this is often how people think about like your clients, okay? Is anyone here would they consider themselves someone that would be purchasing services from a web development agency? Yeah, so there's a few of you here. Often we're presented with things like this next video, and it's really oversimplified. I'm just going to let it play behind me without the sound. But, you know, this video is great. It's super compelling. It's like, oh, my gosh, is that easy to create a website? That's fantastic. You know, and in some ways, it is if your website is simple enough and if you don't give a crap about your audiences and what they actually need, right? I'm not slagging Squarespace or any system, but you can't just drag and drop an image in there, rearrange a couple titles, and think that's going to work across all devices. We've prioritized our content. Everyone's going to understand everything. One of their examples, even, when things are shifting around, all of the copy is lost on the view for one of the tablet views that they're showing there. Well, maybe that's OK, but maybe it wasn't. Right? When we don't take time to actually prioritize our content, think about our audiences, and follow our vision, we just kind of create so-so systems that we're back to the zombie state. right, where our heart is no longer beating, right? Because this is what happens. This is sort of the developer zombie movie. This one's for you, Larry.
Technology is changing our world.
My name is John, and this is my world.
Making what was once impossible.
My name is Anna, and this is my world.
Possible.
My name is Yumiko, and this is my world.
With technology advancing so rapidly today.
My name is Fang, and this is my world.
Imagine what our world will look like tomorrow.
My name is Alice, and this is my world.
To be clear, this is what happens when you don't prioritize your content. Related, developers are badass. But yeah, like this zombie apocalypse happens where we lose control over our world. Things seem like they're okay, you know, and suddenly Alice is the only one fighting for us, right? So the reality is no system is perfect, but many are great. I love Drupal because it is one of the great ones, from my opinion. I'm a big advocate for it whenever I can, even though oftentimes I'm forced into the proprietary CMS world, right? Working with Oracle sometimes even. I know. But here's the thing, right? Your website is a black hole without its content, right? If we don't plan for our content, we're just building fancy buckets, right? With fancy experiences. So this is one of the keys, the core concepts within user experience for the web is understanding your content and your audience's needs for that. Because we're looking for this central piece, this thing that everything revolves around, whether that's looking at Brad Frost's atomic design system and connecting it to people, or even thinking about content that way, looking for this central source of content when we do, oh, there's my dog. I forgot this slide was in there. Isn't that cute? Look at me in my Sharpie tool belt. By the way, if you invent that, I will buy it. But when we look for this central piece of content, this thing that everything revolves around, this is what it looks like. This is often what my user experience workshops look like. In fact, I'm going to be running a responsive content modeling one back in Boston in a couple months, and we'll do some of these things. But this was for the city of Red Deer. They had determined that their most important content view for them was their standard content view. Some people might call this a standard content page because people are looking for a discrete piece of information. They want to know how to register for a dog license, you know, or what's the process for paying their taxes online. They don't want to know what the process is, though, because that's not a real thing. So what we do is we list out all the different content types that are possible here. Now, different systems handle this different way. They were building this one on Terminal 4, which I'd never heard of before. It's a .NET system, but we list out everything that's possible. This could be on based off of their previous site, but often it needs to be beyond that, where we brainstorm for the future too. So things like, hey, the different types of navigation that might be available. We figured out there's 5 different types of possible navigation on this view. You know, the site ID logo, right down to things like alerts, maps, audio. And then we prioritize each thing inside of there. We set them into 3 different groups. So group 1 is essential. This view, this page, whatever, this content template, whatever you want to call it, couldn't exist without these things. So that can be things like navigation, you know, and a title, an H1, right? The body copy itself, privacy policy, right? We legally can't have that without having that there because they're collecting information. So the essential things. Group 2 is great to have, right? So we're thinking about their audiences, we're putting them into prioritization here, but great to have means it fully supports the vision for this, what we're trying to provide. So for them, their feature, no. Yeah, this was a 2. News and notices was a 2. I think even their feature image video that could be across the top was a 2. They didn't actually have to have any of those things to provide the core experience. And group 3 is nice to haves, right? So that often is social sharing, social channels, things like that, which maybe if they didn't exist at all, if they dropped off the list, they'd be okay, but we're probably going to include them. That's the easy part. We go back then and prioritize inside of each group. So those are the red numbers that you're seeing there. Something is a 1-1, which for them was their site ID logo. Not many people would pick that, but they had such a broken brand experience online, and they were trying to establish themselves as the central source of truth for the city of Red Deer, that they prioritize that as being their most important piece of information here. Following that, I believe, is the page title is 3. I think 1, 2 is off the screen right now. It's probably their clarity copy. But what this allows us to do is when we start to think about either future devices or other devices, we say, hey, you know what? We're only going to deliver the first 3 priorities to this tiny little e-paper display on a Pebble watch. We're going to make sure that they know the organization, the title of this, and the bit of intro copy. Right? We actually are able to deliver a congruent experience across these things. We then take it into a sketch here, which is a minimum small screen, large screen. I always start with a small screen, to help us really understand how we are going to represent those priorities, how the audience would actually use them. And this leads us very, very quickly into future stages. But the key to this is that we have to fight through the tough moments together. Right? There is no compromise in here. There is only agreement. And so sometimes these workshops last up to 5 days. Sometimes they're as short as a day together, you know, a 6-hour period, but where we work through all their different content templates and we fight to a moment of agreement. We eliminate all the elephants in the room until we have this great understanding. And so the key to this whole sketch here was these two faces, the conflict, and then understanding and agreement. Sometimes dogs have conflict. This is my dog. Yeah. No photoshopping, right? That's not just a witch's face put on my dog. It's terrifying that, you know, but often dogs will torment each other too, right? And they get to these moments where they actually are in a bit more harmonious situation, right? Aw, cute, right? But the key here is not take it too far. No. I don't know. They're not blood related, so it's okay, I guess. No, but it takes a team to create a wholehearted experience. Right, that's kind of joking there. I believe in interdisciplinary teams. I have a blog post about that if you want to read about it. But that we need to have developers, designers, user experience people, content strategists, tech clients. You know, stakeholders are part of the team, right? And so is your audience. If you can include them in any way, they should be part of your project team. You should consider them that way. Their opinions, their values are just as important. Following the workshop exercise that I had before we were prioritizing things, come up with these documented content models, right? And often the first phase of it just looks something like this. This is just a Google Doc, right? This is that same content page that we talked about for the city of Red Deer, right? Where things, the priorities are represented, but we start to describe the different either modules or whatever system you're having to be using, whatever they call them, the content types themselves. The great thing about this is not only do we have that and a general understanding, but we can easily take those things and move into in-browser wireframes, where we, again, take it out to people to test, right? So this is just built on my variation of foundation, right? Where those annotations that are coming up were from our content modeling exercise. It's an extremely lean and efficient process, right? But all of it is connecting with our audiences, connecting with our project team, and then this is taken out and tested to see, do our updated navigation patterns work? Are people able to find content? Do they notice that there's a green alert on this page? They didn't, by the way. We had to change where it was in its positioning for it to stand out more for people. So the future? I think the future for us is to look for these central bits, that how we're connecting to one another. I do like Brad Frost's system of atomic design. I like to think about atomic content as well, but more importantly, I like to think about the heart of our experiences, the why. When we start to transform who we're building these things for, you know, we move from this question mark to creating more of a wholehearted experience. Thank you. I'm Steve Fisher, and I've got stickers and business cards and stuff around, and I think I've got a little bit of time for questions. Yeah, if anyone has any. So thanks. Do they need to use a mic for the questions,
yes,
for recording?
So if anyone has questions, feel free to go to the mic that's right up there, that are in the hallway. The next session starts in about, you know, 10, 15 minutes, so feel free to enjoy the conference. I do want to remind everyone, after the 12:30 session, come back into the auditorium, and we're going to take the group photo and announce the prize giveaways. All right, so feel free to ask
any
questions.
Yeah, 5 minutes of questions if you want, or if everybody needs to go, they can go. So I'm just going to stick around if you want to ask me questions personally, too. Now I've made it awkward. Oh. Okay, I think everyone can probably go on. If you have a question, just come to me afterwards. And thanks again. Give yourselves a hand.